Well, welcome to a very special Getting to Know Your Neighbor. It's a Getting to Know Your Neighbor tribute to Penny Toy. Of course, with us is her husband, Bob. And Bob just lost Penny in the wee hours, I guess, of Monday, April 3rd. And so it's not been that long ago. But the reason we're doing this is, first of all, Bob, thanks a lot, buddy, for being
Thank
here.
You.
And I know it's difficult for you. But the reason we're here, if you follow my Facebook and some of these videos. Well, it's probably been almost 2 months now that I did put something out there that we were going to do an Indiana Neighbor with Bob and Penny. And then you just never saw anything like that. But the truth is, behind the scenes, we did. We did it about 6 weeks before her passing. And Penny wasn't as strong maybe as what we all had hoped to get through the interview. But what we're going to see today are the parts of the interview that we felt that Penny was strong enough, some lighthearted moments, some very touching moments. But Penny wanted to get across a couple of messages, and she will in the video that you're going to see in just a little bit. One of those is make sure that you listen to your body. Make sure that you're questioning your doctor. Even genealogy comes into effect, as you'll see in the video as well. But ask the questions, get checked out. That's probably one of the main things that Penny wanted to get across today. But I think even a bigger thing that Penny wanted to get across, and Bob's here to speak to some of that, is the prayer warriors. You know, I know that's a name, but that really helped Bob and Penny and the family get through this. And Penny wanted to make sure that you knew it, because everybody listening, everybody watching, was one of those prayer warriors. So that's why Penny wanted to do this. And Bob then, after Penny's passing, called and said, hey, is there anything we can still do, might be able to do? And that's what we're doing now. It's definitely a tribute to Penny. I think you're going to laugh at some of this. I think you're going to cry. If you know Penny, you're going to cry. It's going to be sad at some point. I will tell you right now, at the very end, there's a very special tribute. And I hope that you'll see this, and Bob and his family will have this forever. And that's why we're doing this, because Penny's wish was to finish this, and that's what we've got today. And Bob, if there's anything I left out, let me know. But I appreciate so much that you and Penny trying mm-hmm. to get this together. And I think we finally got it to where the family's comfortable, and I think they'll appreciate what mm-hmm. we have today.
Sure.
But you went through this journey, Bob, right alongside with Penny for three and a half years. And I know it was a very, very difficult one all the way through. Mm-hmm. But you had help. You and Penny had help, whether it's family, friends. But when I speak of prayer warriors, when I speak of people reaching out to you, I mean, I've seen it, the overwhelming side of it. I can't imagine what you and Penny saw.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A lot of people, of course, from community here in Ligoti and the surrounding area there, but you know, I had former bosses, you know, from as far away as, you know, Ohio, and you know, I know all across the globe, so to speak, you know, had a lot of people that we had met over the years and things, and that were praying for us, and is just very helpful throughout the whole process there. So,
but did you ever imagine, you know, if you're a human being, sometimes you think of what your funeral would be like, or what it would be like when you're passing, you know, what will people think? What will people say? I told Penny that I think one of the miracles that she got to experience, it wasn't continuing life, mm-hmm. but it was seeing the overwhelming love and support that people give her. You know, to me, you might not see that in your lifetime, maybe a little here, a little there, but Penny had the time to get those, and people gave them in force, mm-hmm. and I know that was so important, but I think, Bob, that none of us realize the impact overall that Penny had on the people. I know what she had on myself, on Lynn, but then the funeral and you know, the months leading up to it, the love and the support. I mean, how do you even account for something like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's difficult it's difficult to do, and just the many acts of kindness that we experienced and everything. How many people, in your regard, you and Lynn organized the prayer caravan for her birthday, and how many people are able to experience something like that. And that was such a joy to Penny. And at the time, she was still doing halfway well. She had grown back a whole lot of her hair.
Yeah, she was proud of that, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, she ended up with a gray type of color in her hair, as you saw at the viewing and the funeral there. But anyway, just you know, I touched on your act of kindness there, and it just so meant so much to her. And I think you yourself could see that, you know, when you went back to talk to Penny,
yes.
that last week of her life and everything, how much that meant. And we had a lot of people at that time come out to the house and say their final goodbyes. It was somewhat emotional for her at that time and everything. So in some respects, I felt maybe a tad bit of guilt of, you know, that she had to go through that. Mm-hmm. But she wouldn't have had it any other way, and it was just an emotional time there. So
that's what I thought of Penny. I thought, how can one individual who still can understand, who can still talk, maybe she's not strong, but as you said, I mean, people are coming through, such as ourselves, and realizing it's probably goodbye, and I don't know how any one person can do that. And the thing with Penny, and you tell me if I'm wrong, she was never ready to go, was she?
No, not up to the very end. I mean, you know, within a day or so, when she just got to the level where she could not communicate, you know, I'm still going to, you know, I'm going to beat this and everything. She always said that and everything.
Did she ever say she was ready to go, or did you ever sense that she was ready?
Not really. Not really. I mean, she was still, you know, of a night. One of the things that that she had indicated, of course, as you know, Penny was, she was very headstrong in a lot of respects, but she did not want a hospital bed, you know. So we put rails up at the side, and she kept saying it at the end. You know, she kept, when she'd have to go to the bathroom, she didn't communicate much, but she'd flop her legs over that rail, and she said, what's up with this dumb thing? You know, why do we got this dumb thing here, you know? And, but anyway, she continued to, it was some of the sweetest moments I've ever had with her in the worst circumstances, in that, you know, I was able to, you know, she was totally dependent. And when we would get her out of bed, you know, they'd say, wrap your hands around my neck and everything, and she'd give me a kiss to the end, and it was so sweet. And you know, I thought, yeah, I cherished that so much, and the fact that you know, she was extremely loving towards the end there, and very affectionate and things. And you know, it took me and at least one other person to get her situated to, you know, to use bedside commode that we had set up in the room and things. But you know, before that point, I mean, she didn't want to use the bedside commode. She wanted to make her track to the bathroom, to the restroom, and go out, you know, and sit in the recliner and things. So but she still fought to the very end. So
You know, the funeral, Bob, was just, and I know that Penny probably planned a lot of that. Is that fair to say?
Yeah. I mean, I was telling,
had to have everything right.
I was telling our classmate Denise Craney today that really, for the most part, you know, just the funeral was hard for me to discuss with her. She, you know, I knew some of her wishes, but she had sat down primarily with Cindy Hawk and her best friend, and they discussed all the arrangements and everything, and who was to do what, and things. And she had a lot of spiritual guidance from a lot of people and everything, and the lady that Becky Galt that gave the the entrance
that was
welcome at the funeral.
A friend of Penny's and Bob's from Greensburg, Indiana, way back, right, 40 years. 30 years.
We moved to Greensburg in June of 1983, right before our wedding.
That's 40 years, Bob.
It is. I guess it is. Not very good on the math.
But she was just great. Everybody who knew Penny would know those stories. You know, they could almost tell the same stories, but she did it so eloquently. So Becky, if you're watching, you were great. By the way, Jordan, I'm going to cry just saying this. Unbelievable job that Bob and Penny's son Jordan did, not only on the song that I think you will hear at the end of this, but also in the eulogy. I don't even know how you do that, you know, as an individual, and you just lose your mom. But you've got two pretty special kids, Bob. You know that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Penny knew that as well. So all the way to the end, you know. And the thing that I keep thinking of is what Penny did for people. And again, unless you might not know what Penny did for people. I didn't know everything that Penny did for people, but I know that if there was somebody in need, Penny would want to be there. And she was for so many of you and for us. And in the end, you were there for her. And that's, you know, that'd be very important to Penny, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. It was just such a joy. I regret somewhat, though I'm a long way from it, somewhat of a perfectionist, you know, before I think Penny really wanted to watch, you know, our program from before. And I said, well, let's touch up on these particular areas. I mentioned that to you and we could both put her best foot forward, you know. In looking at the one at part of the video, I noticed there were a lot of mannerisms that I had that, that looks pretty bad on tape and everything.
You know, I noticed from that, Bob, with you is you were constantly, the only thing I noticed from you was you were constantly trying to support Penny during difficult times that she might have a hard time expressing. Mm-hmm. And she did see it. Did she see it though? Did she get to
see it? She did see it. Okay. Yes. Okay. She was happy with it.
Yeah.
And she was very happy with it and things. So.
I think that she would really be happy with what we're going to show you today. Because there are some lighthearted moments. I will tell you one of them. Bob started talking about the Washington Catholic Lagoda game from 1980 when we were talking about you and her dating. And she all of a sudden, this is my story, Bob, you know, and you guys can hear Penny saying that. But there are a couple of times where it's lighthearted and we want to make sure we got that in there. But it's a sad occasion for all of us. And anything else, Bob, that you'd like to say before we get to the video?
No, you know that her, she realized just how much Lagodi basketball meant to me. You know, of course, the tournament was just starting and things. And I know towards the end, she had bought me a shirt from here that had Lagodi basketball on it, you know. Anyway, so she was giving me the business. She was rolling her eyes. And Pam Lockmiller was in there about what's she's trying to figure out what was on my my collar here and everything. And then she saw it said Lagodi basketball, and she just looked over at Pam and kind of rolled her eyes. And I, you know, I told Pam I wasn't quick-witted enough because, you know, she's the one that bought me the shirt anyway. So here she is rolling her eyes.
Well, but, and I remember you talking to me about, because you got to go to the games. Mm-hmm. You know, you'd spent so much time with Penny.
Sure.
I'm sure you were driving her crazy for one thing. But you said that she wanted you to try to live as normal life as possible, as difficult as the circumstances were. So you were able to... I don't know if you enjoyed the games. I'm guessing you did somewhat, but you were able to get out and take your mind off of it a little bit. That's important.
Yeah. My daughter was in for the semi-state game. We came up a little short there, but that was enjoyable going with her to the semi-state game and everything. And it was an enjoyable tournament for me. It's kind of like, sometimes just like when we were able to get up and go on the plane ride and everything. You know, basketball's a little bit like that to me, to watch Ligoti when they're in a good run, because boy, you can get away and you enjoy yourself a little
bit. Right. I'm going to talk about the plane ride in this one too. So let's enjoy this very special Indiana Neighbor tribute to Penny Toy. Right. Mm-hmm. So Penny, one reason you agreed to sit down and do this was because you know somebody out there needs to hear this story, right? Mm-hmm. And what is it that they need to hear from you?
Well, of course, we always, you always are telling your kids, and I always told our kids, if you feel bad of anything, you don't mess around, get to the doctor, to the CompaCare, whatever, and get tests done. Don't go thinking that what your generation is that's not going to get you. And so I forced that enough. I think that they finally all went got tested. And then there's the Ancestry.com.
And what she's kind of hitting at there is in the long run, she did find out that her grandma had pancreatic cancer. Jordan searched Ancestry.com, was able to pull up the death certificate, and did see where.
Yeah,
her grandma had pancreatic cancer and died about the same. Died when she was 61, I think, in 1948 or 49.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right. I mean, obviously, know your body, but mm-hmm. get tested, so preemptive.
Right.
So, Penny, another thing that you told me was, as far as the story is concerned, not only to get tested early, just anything is off kilter, but the prayer warriors that you've had, the love support that you have had, it sounds like it's kept you going for quite some time.
Yes, as I say, 3.5 years, I just keep chugging along, and I just ask God, God, don't take me yet. I'm not ready to go. And that usually gets pretty emotional for me.
So many people, of course, even at your stage, we'll say, I'm ready. I'm ready to go to whatever that next life is. You're not ready to go just yet?
No, I want a grandbaby.
All right. Well, let me ask you about that, because in December of 2022, your daughter got married. So most of the year 2022, even though it was a very difficult time for you, difficult diagnosis, you had a goal. You were going to make it to that wedding. And I don't think there's even the least skeptical of any of us that wondered if that was going to happen. But not only did you make it to that wedding, it seemed like a fairy tale wedding.
It was beautiful. She, of course, we have a pretty daughter. She's pretty special and everything. And Jordan, he's a good looking kid. And I still call him a kid because they got two.
He's your kid.
Well, yeah, and he's got two house dogs, and when Grandma comes visit, first thing they do is look in Grandma's bag, because they know Grandma's going to have to eat. And as I said, the wedding was beautiful. It was white roses and red roses and Christmas roses and stuff. And we just, we took it one step at a time, and I made it, and I made that goal.
Any question I ask too difficult, just say pass, okay? Have a feeling you're going to be fine. But when the doctors said, and this is for both of you, but when the doctors said, Penny, Bob, we've done everything we can do, and we're not going to be able to see this through, there's nothing more we can do, what was your thought? What were conversations that you might have had with Bob?
I cried a lot.
Did you expect at that point for them to say that, or did you expect there to be more? I know when my mom had cancer, they would use the term bullets in the gun. We still have a few bullets in the gun left. We can do this. But at this point, the chamber's empty. Did you expect that, or did you expect them to be able to do more?
I was hoping to for them to be able to do more in like dissolving the tumor or stuff, you know, because I mean, you see all this stuff and it just makes you wonder, it's like, why couldn't I be that person? And but it's a type of cancer that they have trouble with.
Just very difficult, you know. We kind of knew at some point in time that, you know, we would come to this point. Yeah. But anyway, it's a shock, you know, and to see, you know, it's just very difficult. Yeah. on Penny, you know, I mean, just to see her, what she, you know, the final word there, and mm-hmm. In terms of, hey, we can't really do anything for you at this point in right. time, that and just the emotions with that, just to see her go through that, and you know, a lot of crying in both in both of our cases. You know, we had I tried to stay myself halfway strong. I'm in some respects, mm-hmm. I'm maybe not a very strong person, but I think in front of her, in terms of the cancer and mm-hmm. things, I tried to halfway remain fairly optimistic. But anyway, I had my moments.
But you went for a flight up in the airplane. How did that come about, right?
Well, Jason and Pam have been our friends, and especially my friend, for several years. So I worked in the restaurant for and made cakes and pies and stuff. And then I would make, you know, the cakes and stuff. And so I always got close to him. And I used to babysit Alexandra. Mm-hmm. And she was one of Elena's best friends whenever they were little. And so we kind of gathered our thoughts together, and she says, "How would you like to go for an airplane ride?"
Just like that, out of the blue.
What? Because how do you go on an airplane ride? Well, I guess if you want me to go. And she goes, "You don't have to." She says, "You just have the opportunity of the Jared's flying in." I said, "Well, okay." So we loaded up in their little Cessna, and it's like trying to put a round home,
yeah.
round hole in a square peg. This is like, oh my Lord, if I crash, this is going to be it, you know.
Bob, I know you'd do anything for Penny, especially during this time. But at that point, did you say, "I'll do anything for you, Penny, except get in that plane"?
No, I didn't. Even though I fell out of a tree as a kid, you know, and that might be what's wrong with me now. But anyway, even though I'd done that, I didn't have any fear there, and okay. felt like we were in good hands and things. Mm-hmm. And it was nice in that, you know, you get up above everything yeah. and get up above everything. You kind of forget all your cares and everything. It was so neat to just kind of look down.
Yeah.
You know, we flew over our house, flew over shows, mm-hmm. the area there, and a few times. And then, of course, we flew to French Lick as well, and that was neat to see, you know, all of that. And just what you see from a bigger plane, but a little closer and yeah. everything. And it was just really neat experience.
Now, one thing I saw on Facebook, Penny, and I kind of wonder, people in your situation, you know, what type of things do you think about when you're alone and such? And I know it seems like one thing over the past, whatever, couple of years, you've had an opportunity to put some things down on paper, some poetry, or have you always done that?
Oh, yeah, I've always loved to write poetry. It's just been something that the talent that God gave me to put words on paper.
But you wrote one on the changing of the seasons, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can I read that for them?
Sure.
All right. So this is a poem that Penny wrote going from fall to winter. They swirl and dance to the music of the trees. The sun shines down, gleaming through the now bare branches. They whisper as they dance like little children playing Ring Around the Rosie. The colors so vibrant and bright, now faded to nothing but a crispy crunch under your feet. They lay like a soft blanket once covered the green grass. There's a chill in the air, letting us know the season is changing. Gone are the beautiful colors that once filled the trees. There's a feeling of sadness that comes over us, telling that the new season has arrived, along with a new color, will come soon. The ground will soon change that will sparkle in the new season. It comes silently overnight, and when we awake, we will see the new season has come, and it's called winter. Now, why? What came to your mind and thinking? By the way, absolutely beautiful, Penny. But you've always been able to put words like that together, yeah. And you've done that as a hobby occasionally?
Mm-hmm. I put it down, and I even add, I have several poems that I ask God why. And I think that comes from like part of my journey. Whenever he would come up to get me, I could hear him coming up from the top of the hill, and I wasn't that far from the highway, and I could just see him just coming down and stuff, because he would drive real slow. And
good move. That's a good move.
Yeah, it's a little smooth.
Yeah.
So is that where you guys did you know each other before Dairy Master, or how did you meet, Bob? I wasn't going to get into this, but if you guys are okay with it.
Oh, probably three or four months before we actually went out and things. Yeah. But I actually think the first time I was ever with Penny much was and I don't know this for certain, but you know, I think it was February. I think it was like it was a leap day back in February of 1980. So anyway. It was on the 29th. I think it was on the 29th. I'm pretty sure. The reason I remember those days is because during that time, I knew Penny for a few months before, but you know, just her personality and everything.
Too,
the way, yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. But
Miss Martin County.
Yeah, she was running.
Jane Porter beat me.
Jane. I remember that. Yeah. I remember that.
Good story. But anyway, I you know, it's one of those types of, you know, oftentimes person, you know, when they see the person they're going to be with or the person they love and things, you know, remember those times.
Yeah.
And but I can remember being in one of those ag sheds, you know, back when they had the Fair Queen contest that was going on.
Yeah.
And I can remember, you know, she caught my eye, and I thought, you know, she looks like just Barbie doll down there. Uh-huh. And she was all made up and everything. And, she did. And, but that was probably 7 or 8 months before we ever started.
Okay. So you had her eye on her. You had your eye on her there at the Martin County Queen pageant.
Yeah.
And do you remember your first date? Do you, Penny?
I mean,
I know Bob does. If there's anything, Bob remembers everything. So, you don't remember that?
No, I don't remember the first date. I remember when we first time.
I remember the first day when we went parking.
Okay, that's a whole other subject. That is a date, though.
But anyway,
parking for you younger kids. Well,
but anyway, it was like I say, 1980, and it was, I can always remember it because, what happened in 1980, that was significant or, you know, in the world of sports for this area back in 1980, if you remember,
you're not talking about the WC game.
Yeah.
Are we going to bring that up again? It's sectional week, Bob.
Now, this is
Yeah, I know it's your story. Anyway, but there is a part of that.
Yeah, there's a part of that.
But I mean, before that, you know, I can remember we got beat, and I went over to Penny's house. I was.
Oh, I can imagine.
I was kind of human, and then, of course, I'm going into Sho's household.
I know. She didn't care, did she?
No, her brother-in-law, and her sister came in, and they were kind of snickering. Because we've been upset and everything.
But you'd seen it right then and there. That's the low that he gets right there until now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What about, Bob, if you watched any of his shows, when I get a chance, I'm always interested in the proposal. Now, nothing spectacular in regards to you proposing to her. Do you remember that? Let's ask Penny first. Penny, what's your remembrance of the proposal? Anything at all?
When we went to buy the rings, had to pay for him because he didn't have his checkbook.
I've heard of excuses. I've heard of bad excuses. But picking out a ring, that's the worst, Bob. Yeah, but it happens. Go ahead.
Yeah, he went to Indian Bloomington, to Shane Company.
Yeah,
that was a big place then. That's where you went.
He cared about you.
Yeah, and he still does because it's the same gem. Diamond instead, but we got the rings and stuff, and then we went. Kevin and Sheila was with us.
Lance, right?
And whenever we went back up to pick it the second time, whenever it was done, I don't remember too much of that day because we just thought we needed to just drink the house down.
Explain that, Bob. Drink the house down.
That's a new term on me.
Okay,
but
this meant that we just consume more than what we need.
I don't believe that for 1 second. Well, maybe a second or two. I believe it. Yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, no. I mean, you know, after a couple months,
it was implied, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
After a couple months, we talked about a future.
Yeah.
After a few months of just dating, you know, I kind of knew that.
She, yeah, I know, but knowing Bob, I thought there might be this grand plan in his, what was it, Nova?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, maybe, but okay. But that's fair. I mean, and that's what happens a lot. It's implied, so there's nothing grand. I just thought I would ask, but it's been a good 40 years, hasn't it? It's been a good ride.
It's been wonderful.
And you know what? There's another goal for you. Make it to your 40th anniversary.
Yeah, that's in June.
It's my goal. Mine's in May, but I'll make it, I think. So let's do a pact right here.
Together.
Let's make it together. Okay. Mm-hmm. So May and June. You make it to mine. I will. She'll see it. Yeah. So what? You didn't really tell me what Bob meant to you, so I'm going to let you finish that.
He means he's my whole world. He takes care of my finances, my medical. He's just, and I don't think I could be here if it wasn't for him.
He's a pretty good guy.
He's a wonderful guy.
And Bob, I mean, you've got a lovely wife here.
Yeah, yeah. You know, she's just always been my world, and since we've been married there, she kind of fit the role model in that, our plans were to, for me to work and her stay home with the kids and things. And she's been a great mother and just such a support for our kids and so active in their activities and things. And she's just always meant a tremendous amount to me and things. And I knew that kind of from the start.
Yeah.
And
to the community she's meant so much. I mean, you talk about your cooking, and I know that I'm sure people have brought food to you probably so much that you're saying, okay, I've got enough, but you in their time of need, in others' time of need that's been in your situation, who's been there? Penny's been there, right? I mean, you've always given to people because you've always cared, and now I hope that you can appreciate what people are doing. I know you can, but what people are doing for you, because it's exactly what you'd be doing for them, right?
Yes.
But during this time, Do you feel like, and maybe the answer is both, but do you feel like your faith has wavered at all, or do you feel like it's strengthened, Penny?
I think it's strengthened a lot because he's got the answers, and he's got anything that you need to ask him.
But surely, if you're human, Penny, both of you, have had to think somewhere along this stage, why me? Why has this card been dealt to me?
I wonder that a lot, but I see no answers to it. I just feel like, you know, this is a reason why it's taking me and not somebody else.
But you also have to realize that no matter when it ends, where it ends, you've been blessed with a wonderful life.
Yes.
I have become, spread your wings and I know.